Today, I want you to grab your Bibles and turn with me to Matthew chapter 25. For several weeks now, we have been in a series called Summer Stories, where we are studying the different parables of Jesus. Today's parable is often known as the parable of the talents. This is ultimately a story about stewardship. All of your life is a stewardship before God. Do you believe that? All of your life is a stewardship before God. Stewardship is often relegated to only conversations about how we take care of and use our money. In all reality, stewardship is a much bigger conversation. Stewardship is not only about your money, but it's about your entire life. God has given you everything you have, your life, your job, your family, your talents, your money, your gifts, your personality, and other things, so that we might be good stewards of these things and use them for the purposes of God. That's what we're going to talk about today. Now, I'm going to pray for us, and then I want to hand it over to our other pastors who are preaching today. God, speak very clearly to our hearts today about how we can be good stewards of our lives and all that you've given to us. Speak very clearly now, and it's in your name that we pray. Amen.
All right, well, I hope that you are enjoying this summer series of the parables as much as those who are getting to preach it. I feel so grateful to have the opportunity to be with you, to share God's with you, whether you're in the room or whether you're joining us online. So grateful that you're with us today. As you've likely noticed by now, the parables of Jesus are very simple stories, and yet they pack a massive punch, don't they? Like, as you've been reading through these stories, they've been challenging texts, and the points that Jesus is making, though they're simple, they are life-changing truths, and today's text really is no different. As you look at today's text, we're looking at the story of the talents, is what oftentimes it's been called. In this story, Jesus uses something that we're all very aware of, even though some of us are better at it than others. It's this idea of financial investment. Now, I'll just admit at the very beginning, I am not great at financial investment. Like, I have a history here. In fact, I never forget back in college, I went to Oklahoma Baptist University, which we call the real OBU for those of you who went to Wichita. But went to OBU, and I was in a business class, and one of my professors gave us a very bold piece of advice. He looked at our entire class, and he said, "Here's the thing. How you invest in your early 20s will have major implications later in life. So here's what I want to encourage all of you to do." This was into our entire class. He said, "I want you to take whatever extra money you can get and invest it in two things, Roth IRA and Apple stock." Now, this was a long time ago, right? And so at the time, Apple had just come out with the iPod, the first generation iPad. If you remember, it had that big wheel and you would spin and you actually had to click buttons and all of that kind of thing. And I can remember thinking, there is no way that Apple's going to create anything better than this. It's all downhill. And so you may be wondering, did you listen to his advice? Well, the fact that I drive a Honda Fit and not a Tesla should answer that question, right? I didn't listen to advice. I did what every other great college student did. I invested in many Chick-fil-A chicken nuggets, which also led to other implications for my life. As you think about that, Jesus is giving us a very similar principle in this parable. The point of this parable is very clear. I'm going to just give it to you at the very beginning so that you'll have it and you can think through this. Here's the point of this parable. How you invest your life for Jesus today will matter for eternity. How you invest your life for Jesus today, right now, the way that you are pouring out your life will have eternal implications. We see this in the parable of the talents. So if you would, grab your Bible, open with me to Matthew 25. We're going to be starting in verse 14. This is the word of God. Jesus says this, "For it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted to them his property. To one, he gave 5 talents, to another, 2, and to another, 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away." Now, this part of the parable gives us pretty much the main characters that we're going to see throughout the parable. On the one hand, you have this wealthy individual who is about to go on a long journey. In order to prepare himself for that long journey, he takes all of his property and he brings in 3 of his servants and he hands them his property so that they could multiply that investment while he's gone. With any of the parables, it's important that you stop and you look at what is the context of this parable. And as you look at the context of this parable, you find that it comes in the middle of Jesus' teaching about his coming return. Already, even though the disciples fully don't get it, he's already told them that he's going to die. that he's going to rise from the dead, that he's going to go to the Father, and that after a delayed period, which the Father knows, only the Father knows, he says, I am going to return. And so constantly in the Gospels, he's trying to get his disciples to realize we need to be alert. We need to live in such a way that we are ready for the return of our Master. But within that context, it becomes clear that, this wealthy individual that's about to go on a journey, it represents Jesus. And these servants, they represent us. They represent his disciples that are waiting for the Master's return. And, the question becomes this: how are we going to invest the talents that Jesus has given us? One of the big questions of this text, and I think something that can cause confusion a lot of times, is this word talent. In the English language, we hear that and we think, well, Jesus must be talking about kind of those things that we're naturally good at, our talents, what we can just naturally do. And so we read this text and we think, well, man, if I can juggle and I can hula hoop and clog all at the same time, this text is saying, well, I need to do all those things for Jesus, right? Well, not necessarily. While that's not wrong, it's missing the full implications of what Jesus is saying in this text. A talent in the first century was a massive sum of money, like an incredibly large sum of money. In fact, it would take a person, a normal day laborer in that first century, 20 years to earn one talent. And so in your mind, as you see the text, don't be thinking $100 here, okay? Think $500,000, think $1 million. The talent was a massive sum of money. And here's what that tells us. It tells us that our Master, Jesus, has been extremely generous with us. Has he not? You think about all the things that Jesus has given to each one of us. He owns it all, and yet he entrusts these things to us. So the question becomes, what are we going to do with it? In this parable, we're going to see three truths about investing your life for Jesus. Three key things that we need to believe and live out if we're going to have a worthy investment when we meet Jesus face to face. The number one truth is something that Nick already pointed to in that sermon intro, and that is this: everything you have is a gift from God. That is a massive statement. If you really believe it, everything you have is a gift from God. This morning, as you think about your talent, here's what I want you to think about. What are the unique opportunities that God has given you today? Those things that he has given you, maybe not the other person, but you, a unique opportunity. Think about your unique personality. Think about the unique spiritual giftings that God has given you. Think about the job that God has given you. Think about the friends, the family, the social network that God has given you. Think about the finances that God has uniquely given you. Maybe it's some have less, some have more. Here's what matters. With all of those things, that's your talent. And with your talent, you're going to see yourself as one of two things. You're going to see yourself as an owner, or you're going to see yourself as a steward. And those are two very different things, aren't they? Here's the mentality of ownership. I own this, therefore I can do whatever I want with it. I can use it for my purposes. I can do whatever I want. It is mine. But the perspective of a steward is very different, isn't it? This perspective of a steward says, man, no, this is God's. I can't do whatever I want with it. If it's from God, I have to use it for his purposes, not mine. One thing I've noticed as a parent is that for those of us who are parents, we often get mad at our children for responding to us in the same way that we oftentimes respond to God in this area of ownership, don't we? If you don't believe me, just put it to the test. I'll give you a little experiment. And for all of you kids online and kids in the room, you're going to love this experiment, because here's what I'm going to encourage you to do, parents. Do this right after the service. Go out and go to Walmart or Best Buy, wherever you want to go, and buy that brand new gaming system that your children have wanted. Okay? Kids, you love me now, right? I mean, it's a great experiment. Go in, and here's the important piece. Let them carry it, pick it out, take it to the counter, but here's the important piece. Parent, you pay for that Xbox, right? You pay for that Nintendo Switch. After you buy that, go ahead and get in that car that you pay for, that you let your kids ride in, right? Go to your house that you pay for, that you let your kids live in. Go to that TV that you bought, that you let your kids watch, and plug in that Xbox and let them play. Take about 30 minutes, go eat a sandwich, go get coffee, and then here's what I want you to do. Go back in and grab that machine and say, okay, now I'm going to take that back. What do you think your kid's going to say in that moment? But it's mine. A sibling tries to play with it. No, that is mine. Wait, did I not just buy that for you 30 minutes ago? Yes, I'm playing, but it's mine, right? Now, if you're a parent, anything like me, at that moment, you look at your kid and say, no, nothing is yours. That clothes that you're wearing, those are mine. Go ahead and take them off, right? You want lunch? Get a job, okay? But here's the funny thing. That's what we do with our kids. We get angry at our kids, but we do the same thing with the Lord when there's anything in our life that we look at it and we say, what? This is mine. God, you can't use it for whatever you want. I want to use it for me. This is for my purposes. Church, here's the principle. We are stewards. We are not owners of everything. Our job, this job, my calling as a pastor at a Cross Church, man, I got to hold this with open hands because it's not mine. My children, they aren't mine. Our house can't be used for whatever I want. It needs to be used for the purpose of God. Why? Because it's not mine. I ask you this question this morning. Is there anything in your life that you look at in your life right now and you say, it is mine? I'm going to do what I want with it. The very first principle is this: everything you have is a gift from God. The master gives these servants everything they have, right? Well, let's see what they do with it. Look with me at verse 16. It says, he who had received the five talents went at once and traded with them, and he made five talents more. So also he who had the two talents made two talents more. But, and that word is important because it shows there's a change about this third person, but he who had received the one talent went and dug in the ground and hid his master's money. Now you see two totally different investment strategies here, don't you? On the one hand, you have the man with five talents, and immediately it says, I love that word immediately, his life is changed. He realizes, man, I've been given this by the master. I've got to use it. I've got to multiply it. And so with every breath of his life, he goes and he uses it to multiply his master's investment. And he ends up doing it, right? He doubles his profit. He goes and he has 10 talents at the end of it. Then you find the guy with two talents. And I have to admit, I really like the two-talent guy. He's not given as much as the first guy. He doesn't have the same kind of ability as the first guy, but he takes what he got and he uses it in the same way, right? He pours out his life for the sake of his master. And I'm really thankful Jesus put him in the text, because if not, what would we do? We'd all look at those 10 talent people like Billy Graham and say, man, I can't do that, right? But two talent guy, I can go with him, right? Whatever God's given me, I want to use it for his purposes. That's the two-talent guy. And he, too, doubles his investment. Finally, you see this third person, and he does the complete opposite of the other two. Instead of investing and instead of using his life to build up the master's investment, what does he do? He digs a hole, and he hides it in the ground. Church, sadly, I think this person represents much of what we see in modern-day Christianity, especially here in the Bible Belt. You think about this. This, on the one hand, this man doesn't do what the prodigal son did in that parable. He doesn't go out and spend it on immoral living. He doesn't go and spend it on frivolous things. No, he just hides it. He kind of puts it in there. If he were in church today, he would be the guy that's in church every Sunday. He was the moral guy. But here's the point. He doesn't do anything with the investment that his master had given him. Instead of using it to build up the master's kingdom, and instead of using it to build up the master's investment, he hides it. He keeps it as a personal thing, never using it to bless others or to grow the kingdom's work. It's a sad description, but it's one that matters because of what we read in verse 19. Look with me there. It says, now after a long time, the master of those servants came and he settled accounts with them. You know, when someone's gone for a long time, you begin to think they're not coming back. And for many Christians, that's the way we look at Jesus. Like, Jesus, we're not sure you're coming back, and so we can just kind of do whatever we want. But thankfully, two of these servants didn't do that. This text gives us a second truth that we need to believe if we're going to invest our lives wisely, and that is this: you will be held accountable for your life. Every single one of us in this room, every single one of us online, we will be held accountable for our lives. After a long delay, the master calls his servants together, and what does he say? All right, guys, show me what you did. Show me. Did you live for yourself, or did you live for me? Did you multiply your investment, or did you just kind of sit on it and do nothing of eternal significance? Church, you need to know that biblically speaking, there are two key judgments or two key moments of accounting that you find in the New Testament. One of these is a judgment reserved for those who have rejected Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. You see this in Revelation chapter 20. It's called the Great White Throne Judgment. It's a moment where those who have rejected Jesus, they refused to turn from their sin and to trust in Jesus, where they are forever separated from the presence of God. It's a terrifying moment that you see in Revelation 20. But here's the good news. To all of you in this room, to all of you online who have given your lives to Jesus Christ, that day of judgment is not going to be a day of judgment for you. In fact, the Bible says very clearly that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And what that means is this: Jesus has taken the condemnation for your sin that you deserved. On the cross, he took the punishment that you deserved. And so on that day, on the day of the great white throne judgment, Jesus, as he looks at you, will not see your sin, but he will see the perfect righteousness of Jesus Christ. Praise God for that. Amen. Great white throne judgment is the first judgment. But there is a second judgment you see in the New Testament. And this judgment you see in 1 and 2 Corinthians, and this is not a judgment that is for people who've rejected Jesus. This is a moment of accounting for believers. It's not a moment where there's going to be judgment or salvation, but instead it's a moment where we stand before Jesus and all of our life, all of our work, all of our investment is laid bare. It's exposed for what it really is. Was it really built for Jesus, or was it built for us? 1 Corinthians describes this in chapter 3, verse 13. You'll see it on the screen. It says, on that day, each one's work will become manifest, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. What a great thing. But if anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire. The picture here is this, church. All that you're investing your life in right now, on that day you stand before Jesus, in the midst of the fire of that trial, it's either going to fade away or it's going to be left standing. Whatever is built for Jesus, whatever was invested for Jesus, he says, man, this is going to be standing and you will receive reward. But whatever you built for yourself, whatever was built for selfish interest, for your own ambition, what does he say? It's going to quickly fade away. Friend, it doesn't matter what you believe, this day is coming. It doesn't matter how much you try to delay it. It doesn't matter how many burpees you do, how many Zumba classes, like this day is coming, right? It's coming for you and it's coming for me. Here's the question. Is your investment of your life today in preparation for that day? What will be left standing? Let's see what happens with the servants starting in verse 20. It says, and he who had received the 5 talents came forward bringing 5 talents more, saying, Master, you delivered to me 5 talents. Here, I have made 5 talents more. Can you just hear the love that person has for the master? He's excited. He's like, man, you gave me 5, and faster, I've got 5 more. You can hear the excitement. Listen to what his master says. His master said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. And he also, who had the 2 talents, came forward. And again, you hear his excitement saying, Master, you delivered to me 2 talents. Here, I have made 2 talents more. His master said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. Man, church, I don't know about you, but I long for the day to hear those words, good and faithful servant. You see, our third principle here, as you think about this truth about investing your life, is this: there is great reward in taking risk for Jesus. There's great reward. We see this in the life of these guys. They take a big risk. They go out with utter abandon, even if it looked crazy, and they spend their life for the master. They take massive risk, and they receive reward. It doesn't matter how many talents you have. in this room, online. It does not matter. Here's the thing. If you live your life in obedience to Jesus, taking risk, I'm just telling you, your life will be anything but boring. The Christian life is a life of risk. Why? Because it's a life where we are called to lay down our lives, to trust God and obey, even if it looks crazy to the world. If you don't believe me, man, just open this book. Read what God calls people to do. Think about Noah. God comes to Noah and says, Noah, I want you to build this massive ark where there is no water. Can you just see him building and all the world around him is thinking, what is this guy doing? His obedience was a massive risk. He could have been humiliated. But what happens? The rain starts, and on that day of reckoning, he is shown to be wise, not foolish. You see this over and over again. David, as he stands up to take on the giant Goliath. Esther, as she stands before the king in order to save the people. Paul lays down his life over and over. It's one risk after another. Christian, is your life one of risk? Are you willing to take a risky investment by living your life fully for Jesus rather than yourself? History is literally a picture of risk taken for Jesus. Think about the people, William Carey, Lottie Moon, Jackie Robinson, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, Watchman Nee, all of these big people. I love what one pastor once said. He said these words, comfort zones don't make you safe, they make you small. I love that. Living in your comfort zone, which many of us tend to do, it's always going to be our movement, it's going to be toward comfort. Living in your comfort zone doesn't make you safe in the kingdom of God, it makes you small. I'll never forget when Rachel and I were praying about moving to downtown San Francisco to pastor that church, how many people came around us and that they asked, Ryan, are you really ready to take that risk? They looked at us and they said, man, it's a risk financially. It's expensive to live in San Francisco. It's a risk professionally. I mean, you're going to go pastor a church in downtown San Francisco. It's going to be a risk of raising your kids. Why would you want to do that in a city like San Francisco? And I can remember as I was struggling through that, praying, God, I feel like you're telling me to take this step. It seems extremely risky. I remember reading a book by John Piper, and he said these words. He said, the Christian life is a call to risk. You either live with risk or you waste your life. Church, my question to you is this. Are you living with risk or are you wasting your life? What risky investment may God be calling you to today? Could it be that some of you hear it online, God is calling you to a divinely directed career change? Like you've been on this road, you've been going, God's saying, I want you to leave what's comfortable and I want you to change gears where you can be more of an influence for my kingdom. For some of you, it may be that God's calling you to step into adoption or fostering of children. There's people all around the Cross Church family that have done that, and it is a risk. And yet they've seen the work of God in the midst of that risk. Some of you, it may be taking all of that money you're saving by not going on vacation this summer, because you can't go anywhere really, except I see all of you at the beach. I'm just saying, I see all of you out there. Take all that money and use it to go on a mission trip this coming year. To say, I'm going to step out of my comfort zone to join the church and being part of a mission that's much greater than me. For some of you, it's smaller things. Some of you need to offer that forgiveness that Nick talked about last Sunday. Some of you need to talk to that neighbor that God's been putting on your heart, but you've yet to tell him anything about Jesus. Some of you this morning, you need to begin to tithe. It's a step that you've said, I'm holding on to my finances. Trust the Lord. Some of you need to step under the dream team. You need to get out of your comfort zone. Some of you have been standing on the sideline in this church's life instead of getting involved and helping in the preschool ministry, in the kids ministry, in the youth ministry. You need to step up and move into an opportunity of serving on the dream team. All of these are risky. I get it. But here's the thing. Every risk taken for the kingdom of God will be worth it. Do you believe that, church? Every risk taken in obedience to Jesus will be worth it. How do we know that? Read the text. What does the master say? Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. Here's the thing. Faithful servants are rewarded with greater responsibility and greater joy. You want to know joy? So many of you are investing your life in all these things that you think are going to bring you joy. Can I just say, Jesus says right here, the only way you'll find true joy is to invest your life for me. And here's the good news. It doesn't matter how much you have. Some have one talent. Some have two. Some have five. Here's where you get your reward. It's based on your faithfulness. What have you done with what God has given you? You don't need to compare yourselves to others. Some of you watching today, some of you are going to have global influence. You're going to have national influence for the kingdom of God. And man, we praise God for that. It's an incredible thing. But some of you, your greatest influence is going to be in your living room. Some of you, your greatest influence is going to be in that classroom. It's going to be in that hospital room where you say, God, I've just taken what you've given me and I've stewarded it for your purposes and not for myself. I haven't hidden it, but instead I've invested for your kingdom. Friends, how are you investing your life today? The good news is no matter what you begin, if you simply are faithful, here's the words you're going to hear. Well done, good and faithful servant. Sadly, the text ends on a tragic note. You look at verse 24, let's read it. It says, he also who received the one talent came forward saying, Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you scattered no seed. Do you hear the difference? This servant doesn't even know the master's character. Whereas the others were excited, whereas the others loved the master, he says this false thing about him. He says this, so I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, have what is yours. But his master answered him, you wicked and slothful servant. You knew that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I scattered no seed. Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and at least at my coming, I should have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to him who has the 10 talents. For to everyone who has will more be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. Cast the worthless servant into outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Church, let me remind you of our main point. How you invest your life today will matter for eternity. This is a tragedy. The person with one talent had the same opportunity that the other servants had. He could have known the master. He could have served the master. He could have loved the master. But here we see he didn't even know the master's character. He hated the master. He was afraid of the master. And so what did he do? He just kind of dug it in a hole and he wasted his life. And on this day where he stands before the master reveals that he's no servant at all, and he cast him out of his presence forever. Church, this is a warning to each one of us. What we do with the talent God has given us matters. You say, Ryan, I don't know if I'm ready to take that risk. Whatever that step of obedience that God has been putting on your heart, I don't know if I can take it. Can I just say this? No matter how big the risk, when you compare it to what Jesus has done for us, it makes total sense. When I think about my own life, Jesus has rescued me from the endless depth of my sin and given me life. Like, I deserved nothing, and he gave me everything. So when I look at this, I say, man, what a privilege that I can use all that he's given me to invest for his kingdom. What about you, church? What about you? How are you investing your life? No matter how big the risk, I'm just telling you, it will be worth it. And there is so much joy in this. Let me just say this. God is after your joy. He wants you to enter into his joy. He doesn't want a bunch of servants that are walking around saying, well, man, I guess I'll invest or otherwise I'm going to have my teeth gnashed, right? No. Jesus is looking at each one of us. He says, I want you to have joy, but you're only going to find it in investing your life for me. So here's three questions I want you to consider as we close today. Three questions that every Christian has to answer today. Number one, do I really believe that everything I have is a gift from God? Do you? Do you really believe that everything, your job, your marriage, your kids, your finances, they're for God, they're from God? Number two, do you really believe that you will be held accountable for your life? Do you? And three, can you be described as a good and faithful servant? When it comes to your job, are you a good and faithful servant? When it comes to your spiritual giftings, are you a good and faithful servant? When it comes to your marriage, are you a good and faithful servant? When it comes to your airline miles, are you a good and faithful servant? When it comes to that extra time that you have, are you a good and faithful servant? Francis Chan is a pastor that served alongside me in San Francisco. He said these words. He said, "Our greatest fear should not be a failure, but of succeeding at things in life that don't really matter." What are you succeeding in today? What are you investing your life in today? If you're a Christian and you say, I don't know what my giftings are, I don't know how to take that next step, can I just say one great next step for you will be to take part in our growth track. We're going to offer a growth track intensive next Sunday night at 5 p.m. You can get on our app, click it, and you can sign up to be part of that. You can go online and do that. We're going to talk about what it means to use your giftings for the kingdom of God. Please join us in that if you've not gone through our growth track yet. But there are some of you in this room today that your next step is actually the most important step. And that is this, it's to say, you know what? I haven't been living my life for the master at all. I realize that Jesus has given everything, but as I look at this text, I see myself in that third servant. I don't know the master. I don't love the master. I'm not living for the master. Can I just say, today can be the day of your salvation. Today, if you will simply turn from your sin, turn from living for yourself, turn from that lifestyle that is rejecting Jesus and say, Jesus, I need your forgiveness. I need you to change my life. I'm just telling you today, if you will trust in Jesus, he can change the entire trajectory of your life. He will forgive you of your sin. He will give you new life, and he will make you an investor that makes an eternal impact with your life. But it starts with that one step of trusting in Jesus. Would you please pray with me this morning? If you're here and that's you, you say, man, I'm that third servant. I don't know him. If I today were to die, I'd be cast out of his presence forever. Friend, today can be that day of your salvation. Today can be the day. For some of you, you've been waiting and waiting and waiting. Can I just say, you do not have tomorrow guaranteed. Today, would you give your life to Jesus? If that's you and you say, that's the cry of my heart this morning, I'm going to ask you to just simply pray this simple prayer after me. There's no magic in these words. What's important is your heart expressed to the Father. And here's what I'm going to ask you to pray. Would you just say, dear Jesus, I've been running from you. I've been living for myself. I've rejected your lordship over my life. But today, in this moment, I am turning to you. I want to love you. I want to follow you. I need to be forgiven of my sin, and I need you to give me new life. Would you please rescue me and bring me into your family? Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for my sin. Jesus, thank you for rising from the dead so that I could have life. Jesus, thank you for saving me. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Whether you're here in this room or whether you're online and you made that decision, can I just say that's the most important decision you ever make. It will be the beginning of a life that invests for Jesus that will make an eternal impact. And so here's what I'm going to ask you to do. Like we do every Sunday, I'm going to ask you to text the number that you're going to see on the screen. It's very simple, 479-343-8777. You're going to text your first and last name. So if I'm texting, I text Ryan Blackwell to 479-343-8777. One of our staff members will begin to have a text conversation with you to help you to understand what that decision means and what a next step for you will look like. More than anything, church, my prayer for you is that you would leave today walking out of this room saying, God, what risky step are you calling me to take? Today, my prayer for you is that you will see that that risk, no matter how great it is, that it is worth it. That today you can be someone that becomes big in the kingdom of God, that makes an eternal difference because of what you're doing today.